Hello, and welcome back to my 30 videos in 30 days series. Today I'm going to show you how I solder together wires. Before we start soldering, I'm going to go over some of the tools that are needed. First of all, you're going to need a soldering iron. One of my favorite soldering irons is a pencil style soldering iron like this. They're great because they're inexpensive. You can buy them for $4 or $5. They're very lightweight, easy to hold onto, and they work really well. The downfall to a pencil style soldering iron, you have to plug this in 5 or 10 minutes before you want to solder. If you're at home as a hobbyist, 5 or 10 minutes is generally not a problem. If you're working in a production shop, as I was for an auto technician for 22 years, you want something that's a little bit faster than that. I always used this butane soldering iron. These are great because, like the pencil style, they're small, but they're cordless, so I don't have to be tied to a cord. They're also great. From the time I turn this on to the time this is hot enough to melt solder is generally about 20 seconds. Third style soldering iron that works really well is this gun style. This is a Weller that I purchased in high school. These are $40 to $50 still today. Weller advertises that it takes 6 seconds for this tip to heat up. I think it probably takes more like 10. Either way, it's quite fast. The disadvantage of this is very heavy. This is way easier to hold on to, especially if you're working in a confined space like under a dash, under a vehicle, even underneath a hood. This is quite a bit to fit into a lot of spaces. This is where I really like the butane. I had the small pencil style and it was cordless. The downfall to this butane though is this is over $100 soldering iron. It really doesn't do any better of a job than this $4 one would do. A few other tools you're going to need. You're going to need some kind of a wire stripper and a wire cutter. These do-it-all ones are fairly nice because that's exactly what they do. They do it all. I can strip wire here. I have the style for the insulated and the non-insulated crimpers. This even has some bolt cutters to be able to break little machine screws or cut little machine screws, something I've never used, but it is on there. And then you have a wire cutter way out here at the tip. I also find that a small side cutters is very nice. This one happens to be a flush cutter. Cutting edge is flush with this edge. On a normal cutters, your cutting edge is a V, and that V then leaves a little bit of an overhang of either a zip tie or wire hanging out. This cutter has a straight edge with the bevel only on one side, so it cuts exactly flush with the edge of the cutter. That allows you to cut the end of a zip tie off without leaving a sharp tail hanging out. It also allows you to snip the wires while making a Lineman splice without leaving any of the solid core wire hanging out. You're also going to need solder. For electrical connections, you should use a 60-40 rosin core solder. That's 60% tin, 40% lead. And by rosin core, that means this tube is hollow, and on the inside of this, there's a rosin paste. Rosin paste is there to clean the wire before the solder. It cleans oxidation off of that wire with the heat of the soldering iron. It's not there to clean a corroded wire, but it's there to clean just that little bit of oxidation off. Generally, not enough that you can see, but enough that would otherwise impede that bond of that solder. Anytime I'm using used wire and I'm splicing anything on a car, I always add a little bit of rosin paste. You're also going to need tape or heat shrink to cover your repair afterwards. The first thing you need to know before you solder wires together is to know what kind of wire you have. Wire comes in two styles. There's a multi-stranded copper wire, which has, depending upon the quality of the wire and the size of the wire, has anywhere from a couple dozen to a couple hundred individual strands of copper wire in it. Or there's the solid core wire, which the size of the wire is one solid piece. Multi-strand wire is much more flexible. This is what's used in automobiles because this multiple strand wire allows it to flex without breaking. In houses, in components that don't have any movement, a lot of times this single strand or solid core wire is used because it's less expensive to produce. Today, I'm going to show you how to solder multi-strand wire. If you're looking to solder solid core wire together, I would suggest going to Make Magazine's YouTube channel. They have a very good 2.5 minute demonstration on how to make a Lineman splice. It is the best way to splice together solid core wire, and it's the only way I would ever splice together solid core wire. I will leave a link to the Make YouTube channel in my description. Check out their channel. Their demonstration is spot on. The first step is we're going to want to strip about 3/4 of an inch to 1 inch of insulation off of the wire. Now that I have 3/4 of an inch of wire stripped off of each of those, I do not twist these together. I see a lot of people, their first instinct is to twist these. I feel that if you leave them like this, they twist together better because this can kind of flatten out a little bit and makes for a cleaner connection when you're done. I overlap the two wires so I make an X. I'll hold one side of the X with my pointer finger and my thumb And I'll take the other side of the X and I'll twist those wires together. Once I have one side of the X twisted, I'm able to hold that side, and then I'm able to twist the other side of the X together. Now that I've done that, I have a wire connection that is just barely larger than the wire of those two wires together, and I have a wire connection that's quite strong already. Electrically, the solder is going to make it a much more conductive bond, but physically, this is already a strong wire. I'm going to use a set of these extra hands for this video. In the real world, I find that these are almost impossible to use. You can never fit a set of these extra hands underneath the hood or underneath the dash. And that's why this connection I really like. It really holds them together tight before you ever make any kind of a solder connection. This step is not that important if you're soldering new wires, but whenever you're soldering old wires, making a wiring repair, I find just a little bit extra rosin or soldering paste on that wire prior to soldering really makes the soldering go better. An acid brush is a good way to get it on there. The number one thing that you need to know for soldering, and it doesn't matter what kind of soldering iron you're using, it doesn't matter what kind of solder you're using, it doesn't matter, you could be using a torch. What you need to know is that you need to melt the solder with the wire, not with the soldering iron. Sometimes one drop of solder on the soldering iron will increase the surface area between the soldering iron and the wire and help heat up the wire faster. But you need to make sure that, as you see here, the wire is hot and the wire is melting the solder. That'll make sure that the solder gets drawn in all the way through the wire. If I was to heat up and drop the solder on top and not get the wire itself hot, that solder will just, it's what's called a cold solder joint, and that solder just balls up on top and doesn't penetrate. And with no penetration, you do not get a strong solder joint. I'll take a photo of this to show it closer, but this complete from end to end here, all of those fibers, all of that copper is pulled in solder. If I was to pull on this wire now, that should be the strongest point of the wire. It should break on one side of that before it breaks inside of that joint. This technique is very similar to a lineman splice, and what I feel is the best splice for multi-strand wire that you can make. There are other ways to do it, but this is what I feel is the strongest, neatest, cleanest way of doing it. Now that that wire has been repaired, we have to now cover that exposed surface. We can do that one of two ways. Electrical tape works quite well if you use good electrical tape. I use 3M Super 33 electrical tape. It is the only electrical tape I will use. Anything less than 3M Super 33 to me is garbage. Has good elasticity to it, so when you wrap it around the repair, that elasticity will pull the tape to the wire and make sure that the elements stay out of it. An even better way to repair a wire is to use heat shrink tubing. First, find a piece of heat shrink that's just a little bit larger than your wire and slide it over your repair. I find a heat gun does a much better job than a lighter. This repair is barely any larger than the wire itself. You end up with a nice, neat, clean repair when you do it this way. Much nicer, neater, and cleaner than a crimp connector would be. Thank you for watching my demonstration on how to solder wires together. I really believe what I'm going to call a modified lineman splice is the best solder repair that you can do on a multi-strand wire. It is quite small, barely larger than the wire itself, so that it's easy enough to conceal back in a harness, back in wherever it needs to go. And it's a very strong mechanical bond and a very good electrical bond. And when it comes to tools, I really believe the $5 pencil soldering iron is your best bet. If you have any questions, please leave them in the comments. I'd love to answer any questions you have about soldering. I'd also like to get into any discussions you have about why you feel that maybe a different solder joint is better than this solder joint. Thank you for watching, and until next time, peace.